views on Twitter. There's a few views on Twitter. Okay, so one of the things you might want to do is to get on Twitter. And what we could be doing is that we could be labeling all our tweets with Strelka. So anything that comes up that you think is relevant, that might be, you know, linked to an interesting piece of research, there might be a quote you want to share, there might be your own thoughts that you want to share. Just use the hashtag Strelka. I've actually already posted the first tweet on Strelka, so it's just a good warning. Well, no, but we might be using that. That's my Twitter address. Now, if any of you wants to, I'm highly interrupted, by the way. You can interrupt me at any point in time or heckle me. I know it's fine. Just interrupt me. But this is my email address, so use this when you want to get in contact with me. It's much better than my mobile. Cool. Alright. So we're going to kick off with the first lecture. And using the funnel approach, we're going to start incredibly broad and talk about philosophy. And I'm so thankful for Alexander to come here out of his busy touring schedule. Because he's not only a philosopher, he's also a great pop star. But that's a different story. He might touch on it, I don't know. But yes, so I would argue that he's probably the only philosopher that's coming out of Sweden.
Probably.
Unfortunately. We have a great engineering culture in Sweden, not a great heritage of philosophy. But yeah, here we have the only Swedish philosopher. Welcome.
Well, we have a couple of Scandinavian philosophers like Kierkegaard. But let's make sure that Scandinavia is I'm very fortunate. I just talked with my new friend in New York here about doing theory and being an artist at the same time, which I think is a very modern combination. People always get kind of suspect when you say that you're both an artist and at the same time you're an academic. But actually, I think it's a perfect modern combination. And it's been a thrill for me. I was very fortunate in the sense I began with huge artistic plans. I left Sweden when I was 17 years old. I went to the States and I went to college. I went to Oberlin College in Ohio, which for all of you who know the American college seems like the most radical place to go. When I was there in the late 1970s, most people who were there were students were bisexual, hippies were Maoists. Nothing is trendier than political opinions. That's always fashion. Politics is fashion. It's never deep. It's always fashion. It's like Occupy Wall Street right now, which everybody's going to serve about. And I say, wasn't there something called Attack a few years ago? It was the same thing. It'll be over in about five months. That's my bias. At most. Maybe 3 months. And we're going to go into that. But anyway, I had plans to become an artist. I wanted to do performance art. I wanted to do video art. I wanted to do all those really snobby, pretentious things that you do if you're a young artist when you use technology and video art. And I went to America and realized that only half of me. And I then left New York for Amsterdam. I lived in the early 1980s. I took loads of drugs and I was a sex worker, which of course is a great story now for me as an old pop star, you know, because I've done all those things that kids don't dare to do. But anyway, I had a little too much of a good life, to be honest about it. And I got really sick. And I came back to Stockholm in the spring of 1984 because my only health insurance happened in Sweden. And my younger brother convinced me to join the Stockholm School of Economics, which I thought was absolutely hysterical. It's just like, why in the world would Alexander go to Stockholm School of Economics? Okay, let's take on the challenge out in Rome. And I applied, and I got in, and I became a student at the Stockholm School of Economics in the fall of 1984, and to my surprise, I enjoyed it. I liked theory, my brain liked it, and I stuck to theory. And then after a year at the Stockholm School of Economics, in 1985, my parents were interested, they didn't care what I did. So I realized that, you know, I had a perfect excuse to do something else. I was at the Stockholm School of Economics since my second year. And I had very huge expenses, because I hate student parties, you know, the cheap way, because I find it boring. I wanted to go go to a really luxurious place. I want it to be a real hipster. I want it to have a cool lifestyle. I want to take tons of cocaine and have lots of sex with attractive people, which is expensive. Like an oligarch in Russia. So I realized I need to make more money. How do I make money as a student? I'm poor. And I decided to start writing hit songs. And I've never touched an instrument in my life. And you know what I decided to do? I decided I'm going to make that an advantage. I'm going to be the only non-musician record producer, non-musician songwriter there ever was. And the funny thing is, this was the mid-1980s. The Macintosh had just arrived. So instead of hiring an expensive studio, which you assumed would be the only way you could make music, I got three Macintoshes and put them on top of each other, you know, somewhere in the corner of my apartment, and started to make music. Now, of course, we all know that 10 years later, this was the model of all music making in the world. It just happened to be a pioneer of new technology. So I started to write songs, and I sent my songs off to music publishing companies, and then one day I got a phone call from Agneta from ABBA, and she was making a solo record, and she loved the song I'd written, and she made that song into a single, and it went to number one in the charts, and I was the new sensational songwriter in Sweden. And it was kind of funny when I did my first interviews, and I said, I'm actually not a musician, I'm knowing you how to read notes. And they were shocked. And they were just like, why don't you have a recording studio, and don't you have a guitar player and a piano player? I have no idea what those things are. I have a fucking computer, that's all I have. And of course, this later became the model for the Swedish music industry, which now is actually the world's second biggest music industry after the United States. You're probably not aware of this, but last week, for example, out of the top five records in the American charts, four were written and produced by Swedes. Contrary to most people believe, for example, when Beyoncé goes up on a stage and sings Irresistible or something like that, most people don't know that the song's written by two Norwegians and a Swede. And I find it totally ironic that most really good R&B songs these days are written by blonde Scandinavians. Just goes to show how totally heterogeneous the world has become. So, I started a record company later. I had my first band of my own called the Armored Lovers in the early 1990s. That sold over 7 million records around the world, and I toured the world. You know about this band. You're probably gay. I became the king of gay disco, and I finally got into a picture of Gloria Gaynor a few weeks ago, Crimea, and music festival. And somebody actually wrote on Twitter, finally the king of gay disco, the queen of gay disco, have met. And they kissed each other, Alexander and Gloria. That was fantastic. But anyway, I have my own band, I have my own record company in the 1990s. I hated running companies. I ended up running a company with office hours, having 30 people employed, and I never had the time to go back to the studio. So I sold it to Universal Music. In 1998, just before Napster dropped, best business deal of my life. I fooled him into buying a fortune to get the back catalog of the Cardigans, and I got out of the whole mess. It was fantastic. Sometimes it just need luck. A lot of things that happen in your life are just down to luck and other things. Anyway, in 1996, 8 years after I'd left the Stockholm School of Economics, it was kind of a fun degree in economic geography, which is absolutely useless. Economic geography is easy to do if you're into economics, like theoretical physics. The only possible career you can have is to become a teacher of economic geography, to teach the whole stupid thing to somebody else who can use it. Because economic geography is absolutely useless. My thesis was on the effects of snowfall on rice production in northwestern Japan. Who cares? I think the only thing I ever did in economic geography was to model how you would build a subway in Helsinki. I don't think they actually used it, but at least they built the subway finally in Helsinki. That's what you do if you do economic geography. It's totally theoretical, no use, no practical use whatsoever. And of course, I ended up doing that. But in 1996, I got a phone call. And this was Kjell Nordström, who's like the guru, management guru of Europe, the biggest one in the East, one of the professors at the Stockholm School of Economics. And his books are worldwide bestsellers, and he's on the top 10 list of speakers around the world. And he called, Kjell called me in 1996, and Alexander, you need to come back to the Stockholm School of Economics. We need you at the advanced management program, and you need to take time to come here, because something very, very important is going on, and it's the internet revolution. And we have searched, we have headhunted everywhere in Europe to find somebody who's both an academic and who works first-hand in the media industry. And we only found you. Because media theorists, or like all theorists, they think they do a proper career out of quoting other media theorists. That's why in my books, I've written three books that have no footnotes. I hate footnotes. Because footnotes to me is just recycled lies. And things don't become true just because you quote somebody else. Just look at Wikipedia. You can spread a lie there and it stays forever. Because as soon as you start being quoted by somebody, they refer to that quote and then somehow it's supposed to be true, and then they refer to it again and again and again, and it stays that way. So don't ever think that a footnote is a truth in any way whatsoever. It's just a recycled quote. But I had this phone call and it changed my life because it brought me back into my other career, brought back the academic me, the guy who loves people. And I was given free rein. I'm basically still, after 50 years, the only sociologist type in the Stockholm School of Economics. I never meet students like you. I'm far too advanced for that. I do advanced management programs. I meet 40-year-olds who were students 15 years ago and now are careers and want to relearn things. That's when they get to meet me. So this is very exclusive. I'm usually too expensive. Anyway. And I started my studies there in 1997, 1998, while my lawyers were busy selling my record company for me, and I was taking a break from music production. I devoted full time into finding out what is the internet. And of course, it turned out that everybody else was wrong. To begin with, most people in 1997, to find out what the internet was, would go to 55-year-old male engineers at Nokia and Ericsson and ask them. And if you ask a 55-year-old engineer what a new technology is, he will give you the technological answer. He will start preaching to you the 150 new functions in the next model of the mobile phone. Who cares? Because we all know that out of the 150 new functions of the mobile phone, 149 are totally irrelevant to us. And the only function we're ever going to use is the one that our friends force us to use because they use it. So I thought, there's something wrong here. Because to do good theory, you have to start by asking the right question. And most academic work, the vast majority of academic work, is useless simply because it asks the wrong question. And the problem is that when people are asking a question, they start to feel comfortable. They start to think because they're asking a question in itself, they're on the right path. And then they look for the answer to the question. That's linear thinking in its essence. It's having a question that you got from out of nowhere, not questioning why that question is there, and then start looking for an answer thinking you're doing a good job. The problem is that most of the time you're doing a very sloppy job because the question you've addressed is the wrong one. This was a perfect example of how easy it was for a guy who came directly from the media industry in 1997 with minimal resources at the Stockholm School of Economics to do some really genuine pioneering work. It wasn't because I was a great person or because I was a genius. I was, again, just lucky being the only one who got it. Because I'd been connected to the internet already since 1987, I could draw conclusions from what people's behavior was. Essentially, all computers in the world are going to be interconnected with each other, so there'd be only one huge computer. Now, what would that do to people? It would probably be a very dramatic difference from before. It would probably be a revolution. It wouldn't be hard to tell. The question is, what kind of revolution is it? Well, to begin with, revolutions are all about readdressing questions. If history ever changes in a dramatic way, if we live in a paradigm shift, if we live in a very dramatic era in human history right now, it's because we are readdressing the questions of what it means to be a human being. In the very essence, that is what philosophy does. Philosophy is the foundation on which you build your house. You can spend all the time in the world on building proper walls and a beautiful roof, but if the foundation is lousy, your house is going to collapse like most Russian suburbs are at the moment, because they're sloppily built. So don't build sloppily. If you're going to do theory, start by looking at the world with fresh eyes, ignore what your parents told you, and make sure you ask the right question. So what did I do with my little budget? Well, I skipped going to Ericsson and Nokia, all of them were comfortably next doors in Stockholm and Helsinki. And instead, I went to Korea and asked 17-year-old schoolgirls what they were doing with their mobile phones. Because the way the world looks today, 17-year-old schoolgirls in Korea do things first, and then the rest of the world copied them. And 5 years later, eventually, heterosexual 55-year-old Scandinavian men do as the Koreans go against them. So why start with the 55-year-old men in Scandinavia when I could go to Korea, which I love, by the way, it's a wonderful country, and they kill themselves more than ever before. It was just in the news today that Korea has the highest ever measured suicide rate in human history. That probably means they do something right. They're taking risks at the moment. So, I talked to the Korean schoolgirls. I did good sociology. Good sociology is not asking people questions straightforward. You ask them abstract questions, which confuses them. Because when people are being asked questions that they understand, they start to calculate how you're going to use that answer. So if you're going to do good sociology, you ask abstract questions. You ask people, who are you? That's a very abstract question. People go like this. Who are you? Do you know what the Korean schoolgirls answered when I asked them, who are you, in 1997? They did this. And then they opened their mouth, and by that time I already have an answer. They picked up their mobile phone and started twitching it like a kid does with a teddy bear. Now, what kind of answer is that? I asked them, who are you? They pick up their mobile phone and they twitch it around. What are they saying? They're saying they are a mobile phone. I am a mobile phone. If you take the mobile phone away from a 70-year-old Korean schoolgirl, she will definitely commit suicide. Right away. You will have taken her whole identity away from her. Now, what is a mobile phone? What is it socially? Not what you think of your mobile phone. I couldn't care less. That's a narcissistic attitude. What do other people think of you when you hold your mobile phone? How do other people think of you when they see you and your mobile phone together as one unit, as one modern body? They think of your mobile phone as your address book. In other words, if you're going to start right now here, 2011, and look at what it means to be a human being today, in a global sense, for all young people in the world today, I would say that the best definition we can make of what it means to be a human being in 2011 is that you are your address book. You are the people you know. Not because you've chosen, because social identity is something you're given by others, it's not something you can choose. Something you're being forced to become, and other people force you to become. But in the eyes of others, when you meet a new person in your life, the first thing they're going to think, subconsciously they're going to think and throw at you, is who do you know? Because we live in a world which is now obsessed with networking. Networking is from now on and into the future, with a stroke of arrow, networking. I know the network society, and I know the information society, and I know the communication society are all cliches. But you know what? I'm a philosopher. I love cliches. Because the reason why people use cliches is because they're true. They say something about the age you live in. And why we say the network society, why we say the information society, why we use these cliches to think of the world today is because they're true. We are obsessed with networks. That's exactly why people spend so much time today on their Facebook pages. Not because they enjoy it, but because they have to. Because other people are looking at their Facebook pages and then judging them accordingly. If you apply for a job in Moscow in 2011, they're not going to ask you which university you went to, which courses you took. They're going to ask you, who do you know? And they're going to ask it by the day before you do your interview, they're going to go to your Facebook page and check out exactly who you know. And you shouldn't know as many people as possible. It's a terrible mistake some people do with Facebook. I think you should have 5,000 friends. If you have 5,000 friends on Facebook, you look either totally unrealistic and stupid because you're afraid of conflicts and you add everybody who wants to add you. It means you're being sloppy with yourself. It's like not taking showers in the morning. You won't get the job. Well, you can have 3,800 friends like Alexander Bard because I'm a social monster. That's perfectly okay. But very few people do. And very few people are old, like me, 50 years old, so they had time to meet that many people that they actually know. But if you're young, you should maybe have a few hundred friends at the most, because that's probably likely these are the people you actually know. And what you're doing with your Facebook page is not you're adding people because it's fun. people think they use Facebook to have fun. No, they use Facebook to survive. That's what people do with Facebook these days. Facebook is a survival mechanism. You actually add people on Facebook, if you're clever, to tell third people who you know. This is quality information in our age. Who do you know is the most important information about yourself that you provide to other people. And this is where you have to start being absolutely honest. Because if you're lying about who you know, then you become a sociopath in the eyes of others, and they'll never ever want to know you or talk to you ever again. Credibility starts with being honest about who you know. This is your most important asset. So where are we at then? Okay, I'm going to get a pen, and I'm going to use the whiteboard. Not PowerPoint, because I want you to interrupt me and ask me questions. And PowerPoint, and I'm in the music industry. Using PowerPoint is like performing playback. It's all directed in advance and you can't interrupt. So somebody shares, you just have to go along the line because your song is 3 minutes long. It's going to last 3 minutes. So I have gone back to the whiteboard with a very old school note to tell me exactly for you to be able to interrupt me and ask questions and comment comments. So please do that, okay? There's not going to be a question period after I'm finished because by that time, the next speaker comes up. Please interrupt me. Okay. I give you an example of how we human beings construct an idea of ourselves and the world around us, and how we construct a worldview, because values always begin with a worldview. Begins with an idea of what the world is. Have you seen these things before? Stone, bronze, iron. Have you heard of those? Three prefixes. O with the suffix H. Supposedly there was a stone age, it was followed by a bronze age, and the bronze age was then followed by an iron age. Have you heard that before? Yeah, they still teach this to kids at school in 2011. It shocks them. Why? Well, let's put it this way. Do you think stone age people were aware that they lived during the stone age? You're not even laughing. You should laugh by now. You know, it's a ridiculous idea. Of course they did. The family Flintstone did not exist. There was no Stone Age! It's made up! History is always made up! Historians are great in this sense, because as philosophers, we're not really interested in history. We're interested in what's called meta-history. The great thing about the production of history is that history writing is always time-specific. Historians are really shabby guys, and they're really poor. And the only way they can make a living is by writing a history that flatters the current power structure of a given society. For example, the only historians you have in Moscow in 2011 are employed by oligarchs. So they will write beautiful histories about oligarchs. If you were a historian in Europe in the 13th century, you would write, in the beginning there was God, and there were 7 days, and he was born, and he created Adam and Eve, and blah, blah, blah. That was the only history available in Europe in the 13th century. So people believed in it because you will always believe in what you have available. You cannot believe in something that's not available. If the only history that's available is Adam and Eve and God in 7 days, then that's the history you believe in. And people did believe in that history. There's not a single example, any historian whatsoever, anywhere in Europe up until the 16th century who questioned the myth of Adam and Eve. History is just bullshit. But it's bullshit for a good reason. It's revealing. So we use history here to reveal what a power structure of a given society looks like, since it's the guys who have the power in that society who pay the historians. So if we Google human history to look for these terms, what do you think this terminology was used for the first time? Have a guess. Where do you think the word Stone Age pops up for the first time? In the Bronze Age! Yeah, there wasn't even written language in the Bronze Age. Now you have to think smart about it. Wait a second, look at what these things are. What is stone, what is bronze, what is iron?
Resources.
The meanings.
You're getting close, resources, yes.
Instruments, meanings of instruments.
Yeah, they're physical materials, they're physical to be tamed, domesticated. For a specific use.
It's marks, it's a lot of quotes of Karl Marx.
Yes, he written Marx. I could have done that. Karl Marx was the Alexander Bard of 1840s. He was horrible at economics, but he was excellent at sociology. He's still very much alive in the world of sociology. But don't ever do Marxian economics. You know the Soviet Union. You know this. It doesn't work. But anyway, physical materials to be tanked. Now, wait a second. Physical materials to be tanked. Who's got an interest in paying him to construct the history of physical materials being tanked being the most important thing that ever happened in humanity?
Because it's a process of civilization.
Well, back to who pays for this kind of history being written? Who paid for somebody to then bestow it? What kind of purpose did that history serve? We're going back to 1850. That's when the term Stone Age appears for the first time, as do Bronze Age and Iron Age. They were invented together to tell a history of physical materials, because there was somebody out there who wanted us to write and understand history from the perspective of that
originally there was a Stone Age,
and then came the Bronze Age, and then came an Iron Age, and then one day we built a factory! Voila! The purpose of human history was to build a factory. All the other stages before the construction of the factory were aimed at one day building the factory. That's the purpose of history. Of course, then, who paid for that? Well, somebody paid the historian in 1850 to invent this history. And who did that? The factory owner! Oligarchs! The factory owner paid. And that's exactly what happened. If you go back in history and you look at Europe in the 1850s, industrialism was exploding. Balzac wrote beautifully about how the nouveau riche, the industrialists, the bourgeoisie, were living in the cities. And they were taking over and controlling society. This was their society. They constructed republics, and they had presidents, and they had democracies, and they had newspapers. Everything that we think of as urban society was constructed in Europe in the 19th century. And the guys who owned the factories, who wanted to get laid the most, were the most females around them, just like Russian oligarchs today, which means Russia is a very old society, not very modern. It's not a great country, by the way, we're going to go into that later. They paid! The scary thing is not that they did so. This is a beautiful way of constructing a society. I admire the industrialists, in a Nietzschean sense, for being so forward-thinking, for being winners. We're going to try to do today is to make us winners in 2011. And the first thing that we should do is to say that, for God's sake, do they still teach Russian school children today that it was a Stone Age? The really upsetting thing is not that the Stone Age is a myth or that it was a lie. The upsetting thing is that it's so totally irrelevant. Because relevance is what's important. Like David said before about theory, the theory that can be put into practice is useless. This is all a question not about truth and lie. This is all a question of relevance and irrelevance. And what I want us to do today is to think of us as HIP students, as you are here. What is relevant for your world? Because the world that you are going to be part of constructing, you're going to do city planning and architecture, build a new mosque or whatever, what you're going to be part of is that you're going to drag poor, uneducated people into your world and make them educated and make them interactive and successful in the new age. That's your fucking job to do. That's why you're here at the Strong Club. Somebody's at least good enough to pay for you to be here so that you, as individuals, become part of constructing the new world. And in this new world, you have to understand what kind of history writing will be relevant here? So when I look at these things, taming of physical materials, let me then propose we'll do it the other way around. Let's say that we live in 2011, now we pay the historians to write a history that flatter us. As Strelka students, you can't be any cooler than a Strelka student, can you? In 2011, you can't. No. You're all social monsters. You all have computers. You're all interactive. You all have David Erickson heading your
So instead of going, oh, the information society is such a cliche, let's go deeper within that term. Let's start to take the word information society seriously. Not just use it, throw it around and say it's a cliche, but rather say it is a cliche because it tells the truth. Now, what is an information society? Well, why not go radical? Why not say all societies that ever existed have been information societies? We have gone through ages, different stages of information processing. And what we've done throughout history is that we have made these processes more and more sophisticated so that we as human beings can have more and more complex information structures and build more and more complex and specialized societies. That is what wealth is. Wealth is specialization. Wealth is that instead of doing everything by myself to survive, I specialize in one tiny, 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 tiny bit of human activity, which I'm really, really, really good at. I think at Strauss Institute. You're not even making your own coffee here anymore. You have experts out there who make the coffee for you because you're specialized in being Strauss. And we live in a world today where we are more specialized than ever before in human history. And the only reason we can be more specialized than we ever were before, and thereby create more wealth than we ever did, which we then can share as human beings, is simply because we have access to more information than we ever did before. Having access to information is the key to how advanced a society can be. Please write that down. Having access to information is the key to how advanced a human society can be. That is a philosophical formulation of what an information society is. Like so many. You know what's the interesting thing here scientifically? The interesting thing is that we human beings are four different forms of communication with each other. We've introduced these four different forms of communication at different stages, at different ages in human history. And with each new level of communication we have introduced, with each new form of communication we have started to use, we have actually seen an explosion in accessible information. And that is great, because then we can do empirical. We can provide empirical evidence for a theory. This is just not a theory like Adam and Eve and all that, because Adam and Eve would have been a much better story if somebody had the bones of Adam and the skull of Eve somewhere, but they never did. But you have a much more convincing story if you can actually prove that it's valid. And that's something we can do. So, what are the four different forms of communication between human beings? How do you communicate with other human beings? Four different forms of communication. Well, I can go to a bar in Moscow on a Friday night and find myself being really drunk, standing there going, boo, 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 boo. And you could not tell the difference between an ape and Alexander Borg. You could not. I would look like a monkey. I'd be very drunk and I couldn't even talk. Okay? So what is the difference between monkeys and human beings? What do we do that they don't? Monk? You don't know?
Just like
you
are thinking.
You are thinking, you think. Sound a little shorter. But what do we do that monkeys don't? Come on, guys. We speak, yes.
And we write down.
Wait. That's not a difference between us and monkeys. That's what the difference between different human beings. Spoken language is the first thing that makes us different from human beings, from monkeys. Which is interesting. This is also interesting how sociology can differ from other sciences. We will learn that human beings have existed for 7 million years. That's because in biology, in the world of biology, you cut a species by fucking with somebody else and not having children with them anymore. So only because monkeys and human beings could not have children together anymore, we separated 7 million years ago, so biologically human being, 7 million years old, as is the monkey. But sociologically, we're not human beings unless we talk. And we've only talked for about 100,000 years. The organs that you need, the top of your throat, to be able to say onk onk and onk ink, meaning I want to fuck with you, I don't want to fuck with you. To be able to express things in the abstract, which is what you do when you speak, is something we've only been able to do for at the most 150,000 years, which is interesting. So sociologically, we've only been human beings for 100,000 years. Then it starts there with the spoken language. Then you are touching the second form of communication, which starts, ironically, in a country called Iraq, about 5,000 years ago. Which is what?
Writing.
Written language. Let's go to our empirical test. Where do you find the maximum amount of information available to build a society on when you're a nomadic tribe that has spoken language as your most advanced form of communication? Where? Well, if you look at the nomadic tribes that walked through current Kazakhstan 10,000 years ago before there was any written language on the planet, if a child died, they just threw it away. Just goes to show how values are actually always created in the circumstances where they're at, and how relative values are. Because we live, of course, today in a modern society where if a child dies, it's considered a catastrophe, a disaster, you know, all those things. But back in those days, they were just like, oh, a child died, boom, throw it away. Have another child. Yeah, let's fucking have another child. Then they have more children. Now they have like maybe 30 children throughout a lifetime. Women gave birth to children all the time. So, boop, boop, boop. They were probably getting out because most of them died. And they couldn't care less. This happened all the time. But if an old woman died, she would get a huge grave. And all archaeologists will tell you, the first thing they'll tell you is that we always look for small graves and huge graves because they determine the values of that society. They reveal what kind of values that society had. Now, why in the world would they build a huge grave for an old woman with no teeth left who was 8 years old with Alzheimer's when she died? Because when she died, everything died with her. The maximum amount of information available in a society where you only have spoken language is whatever you can stuff into the head of an old woman. But when she died, that probably meant you would have 6 or 7 disastrous years for the tribe ahead of you, where you would eat poisonous mushrooms and not have fun with them. Genetics, they would actually poison and kill you, and you would fight other tribes and you would lose because they had more knowledge than you did, etc. You could not find more knowledge or information anywhere except in the head of an old woman. So you cannot build a society more complex than the information you can store in the head of an old woman. No wonder this is a society people are walking around all the time, because they're in constant chase of food. And the only way to get food is by constantly being on the move. So you take any tools you can possibly get your hands on so you can get on the move all the time. That's exactly why you are nomadic. Because you cannot construct a more complex society than a nomadic society. That's the only knowledge, the only information you have access to. There is not a single example anywhere on the planet of a society with permanent settlements where the most advanced form of communication is spoken language. Not a single example. That's how strong my thesis is. You get it? What happens then? Somebody starts scribbling in southern Iraq and realizes that Onkonk and Onkink can be written. There's a lot of side effects of that. They can, for example, decide that somebody can own a piece of land because they can actually write that down. Agreements between people can be stored forever. You can sign a document, for example. There are all kinds of things that historians have already revealed that the revolution of written language brought with it. It's not even controversial, anyway, to say that written language is actually the precondition for a permanent settlement. No problem at all. But the most beautiful thing with written language is that before that old horrible woman dies, we can go and interview her. We can go and ask her, which one of all these mushrooms of these pictures are poisonous? That one. Okay, baby. And we interviewed her and we stored that information and written it down, and then she dies, we go, the old woman is dead! And there's no problem if we don't need a big grave for her or anything like that. Because we're not gonna have 6 terrible years after she died. Because we've stored the information outside of our brains. That's the beauty of written language. It enables us as human beings to store information outside of the human brain, meaning we can have much more information available. And that's exactly what happens. With written language, the amount of information available to human beings explodes over 1 million times over. What is the result? We're building a far more complex society. Already 4,000 about a millennium into this revolution, southern Iraq on its own had over 50% of the entire population of planet Earth. Because the first thing they could do when they built the primary settlements was have lots of children who wouldn't die, who would survive. They were building huge villages turning into cities. And about 40% of the remaining population of planet Earth lived in other river deltas like that one, like Egypt, India, and southern China. That's where the concentration of the human population was. So, no doubt about it, this was a winning model. We can definitely speak of a new pair. Britain Landers has changed the course of human history, has changed the idea of what it means to be a human being. Now we fast forward to New Year's Eve 1999, going into New Year's Day 2000. This is 11 years ago, and I'm at least old enough to remember it. I don't know if you are. I'm old enough to remember it. I remember that there were all these magazines coming out talking about the last millennium, and finally people realized that Britain wasn't really the superpower of the last millennium. Spain was, you know. It's 1,000 years, it's a long time. But there was always this technologist section as well in there that said that, you know, which was the most important technological innovation of the last 1,000 years? And in every magazine of its kind, anywhere in the world, the same innovation always won hands down. The most important innovation in the last 1,000 years of human history was which one?
Print.
Why? Because the printing press is the third way we human beings communicate. The printing press is another word for mass media. What happened when the printing press arrived in Europe in the 15th century was that we could now mass produce text instead of handwriting it. Europe, around 1450, had an army of people who were handwriting books. They were living in monasteries, and they were probably quite well paid. There was an army of these people in 1450. 1550, they were all gone. They were all gone. There was not a single one left. There was no purpose at all for them. You know, why would we have handwriting left when we have prints? With the printing press, we can mass produce text cheap. Actually, China was ahead of Europe. This just goes to historical wrong irony. China was ahead of Europe when it comes to inventing the printing press, but China didn't have the one thing Europe had. It was cheap paper. The innovation of cheap paper was actually 100 years before the printing press, but it was the combination of cheap paper and printing press that made Europe so successful in exploiting this new technology. So, what happens? You mass produce texts cheap. That means they come into circulation. That means more and more people can afford to learn how to read and write. The more people who learn how to read and write, the more people want to express themselves. They produce more text. As it's producing text and then distributing it's cheap because of the printing press, this starts a feedback loop that generates book publishing companies. Eventually somebody comes along and says, why do you release only one book a year? Why don't you release one book a day? It's called the newspaper. Then we got paper money. Paper money is a beautiful innovation. It just goes to show how innovative human beings are when they use metaphysics. I'll give you an example of metaphysics. How much is a $100 bill worth? Come on. You're being too clever. What do you get for a $100 bill when you go into a shop? You get goods for the value of $100. So it's worth $100. But you're also right that it's only worth a couple of cents. You know perfectly well that it's worth a couple of cents. But the reason you behave as if it's worth $100, because you would never behave as if it's worth a few cents. If I give you $200 bills, you go, yeah, I can go shopping. You don't go, oh, that's only a few cents. You need this. That's exactly what this is about. People who actually take reality of what it is, autists, for example, they are not very socially successful. Because the trick to be a successful human being is to behave as if things are the way they pretend to be, to be metaphysical. This is a perfect example of metaphysics. You take the $100 bill with you and you behave as if it's worth $100 because you know that all the other people on the planet are so fucking stupid that they want to behave as if it's worth $100. So you behave as if you are as stupid as they are. That's beautiful. That's very, very efficient. So all of a sudden, we have this behavior. We were printing paper money starting in Sweden in the 17th century. So which means we wouldn't have to go around carrying huge coins and carrying around gold and even rubber all the time. money, you know, maybe the Swedish king or some Russian oligarch printed on it, and we're behaving as if it was worth what it said it was worth. That is a beautiful thing. And it made society very, very efficient because we could start to trade in a much more efficient way than we ever did before. So the printing press did really three beautiful innovations in one. Book, the newspaper, and paper money. All coming out of the same machine. This is a huge revolution. And again, we go back to the empirical thing. Is the amount of information now bigger than before? Are you kidding? When we can start to print text, we create huge libraries everywhere around the world. And we have far more than 1 million times over more information available to us human beings than we did before. Do you actually know that your brain is much smaller now than it was 5,000 years ago? Human brain is smaller than it was 5,000 years ago because we use it less. We don't have to use the brain all the time. We can afford to be rather stupid. Because the information is there all the time, everywhere, anyway. So why would we have to store it in our brain?
And consume less energy.
It consumes less energy, too. It's very efficient, yeah. If that ever was a problem, we consume too much energy anyway. But, okay. Let's not get too deep into that. Okay. Here comes the next thing. I told you before that get on the wrong path to analyze something if you ask the wrong question. You have to rightly ask the question. And we live in a society where technologists usually are the ones to ask the questions, but to ask the right questions for us, we need to be good sociologists. So we're going to ask very different questions. So don't take the technological questions for granted. Rather, ask yourself, is this a technological question or a sociological question? If it's a sociological question, you're fine. If it's a technological question, it's probably the wrong question. Here's a perfect example of that. When I started analyzing this in the late 1990s, people were only looking at technologies as if they were technologies. That's it. So they would constantly say, well, there's not really a big revolution going on right now because what really happened in the 20th century is that electronic media arrived. Well, I couldn't care less if something is electronic or not. That's a technological issue. I only care about sociology. I care about something that's used. And here's the really scary thing. Radio and television arrived in the 20th century. But sociologically, radio and television are printing press. They function exactly like a printing press sociologically. They are very, very expensive to run. They're run by very few people. And they mass produce information, dictate to people how to behave. That's exactly what books and newspapers also do. Books, newspapers, radio, and television are all printing press, all mass media. But what really, really struck me, and why the internet makes people so confused, is that people hadn't realized that the internet is the fourth communications revolution in human history. It's a new way of communicating. It's interactivity. The interactive language is a new language. It's a brand new language. In what sense? Well, how does mass media function? Mass media functions like this. You have a guy here at the head. The rarity is the guy at the head who controls a body, giving orders on how people should behave. This is the writer of the book dictating to his followers how they should behave. This is the newspaper publisher dictating what the world looks like, giving us an official idea of what the world looks like. BBC, a country. No? Channel 1, Russia. Vladimir Putin says, go on. Dictate. This is also how radio worked. Radio was a really, really, really scary technology. Thank God we got television 20 years later. Because the scariest societies human beings have ever invented were the ones when radio was the most advanced form of communication. There was no television around. Nazi Germany and Rwanda in Africa in the early 1990s were radio-driven societies. Thank God we got television. Because television is radio with a picture so we can see the dictator in his face and realize he's an awful person. Because as long as Hitler only spoke and you couldn't see him, he was really terrifying. Thank God! Radio's a magical instrument. But we got television. Just out of your luck. Ironically, it was the Nazi Germans who invented television. stations around. You need a license to run them. They're expensive to run. But once you have them, or if you have access really to the owner of the railway station, for example, in Russia, if you're an oligarch, you make sure you control TV stations. You make sure you control railway stations. They're yours, you own them, and then somebody follows your orders that dictates to people how they should behave. That is a mass media society. I'm not saying it's wrong. I'm just saying it's extremely efficient, but it's now become historically irrelevant. It's being killed from the bottom up. Why? For a very simple reason. Remember I told you that we had an army of people in Europe in 1450 who were working on handwriting, copying books. Most of the Bibles. They were all gone in 1550 because the printing press made them redundant. Here's the weird thing. There have been done all kinds of studies over the past 50 years around the world. But the funny thing is, when you put an interactive tool where you don't consume anything anymore, you don't consume information, you take in information and then alter it before you send it back out. That's what interactive means. You never consume information passively anymore. You take part in information and then you say, I don't like that, I'm going to change that. Then I'm going to send it off to my friends and see what they think. I can't even read Wikipedia anymore without getting distracted by all the sloppiness in the Wikipedia text. I change it. I'm Wikipedia funny. I just change it. No, that did not happen in Moscow in 1722. That was 1724. I need to change that and reference to it. No. You know, you change it all the time. You send it back. Because I'd hate to read Wikipedia if I couldn't alter it. I'd be frustrated with how sloppy and bad it was. It's like reading Encyclopedia Britannica. It's an awful book. It's full of mistakes. Things that I know better than they do, and I want to change that because I'm an interactive person. This is our. We have not found a single person on the planet who gets an interactive tool in their hand who goes, I hate the interactivity, I want to go back to mass media. It's not a single example. This is so powerful. This is so attractive. This is so wonderful to people to be able to be a part of the information process, to be able to alter it, to give your input, to comment, to change, to share, to co-create, it's like a dream come true. Just like it must have been when the first permanent settlements were built in southern Iraq 5,000 years ago. What do you think would be the first reaction of a nomad when somebody told them, you don't have to move around anymore, you're going to live in this place for the next 30 years? It must have been one big, wow! Wonderful! I don't care if I get fat and die younger. I don't care. I don't have to move around anymore. Wonderful. That must be like paradise. It's the same thing with attractivity. It's so attractive. People love it so much. It plays so much into the human instinct that there's no way we're going back. I'm on a show called The Idol. You have The Idol? You know, Idol is a huge, you know, global TV show. I'm on the Idol jury in Sweden. People ask why I did the Idol show. And I said, I do the Idol show because it's interactive. It's really fake interactivity. Because old media, television, radio, books, etc., they all have to fake interactivity at least to keep people's attention. And what I say is that I'm on the Idol jury and I give my opinion. That people love to vote against me as much as they love to vote with me. Because at the end of the day, people wouldn't watch the TV show unless they decide who wins. People do not participate in any form of media circulation anymore unless they're involved. That's the death of mass media. There is no way the traditional book, there is no way radio, television, any of these instruments will survive once interactivity takes root. Bad news for Vladimir. Putin's world is a very old world, and at least the rest of the world is dying. Medvedev is a very fake Putin, yeah, it's just a doll, a Russian doll. You take Medvedev out, there's nothing there, yeah. They tried, you know what? What happened? This is why I'm using the printing press as an example, because you can learn from past mistakes and make sure you don't repeat those mistakes. You know, Gutenberg, when he invented the printing press, when you ask, if you've done an interview with Gutenberg in 1450 and asked him, why did you invent the printing press? Gutenberg's answer would be, I have invented the printing press so that we can print Bibles cheaply on all the local languages around Europe, so that European people can read the Bible finally and understand it and become good Christians. What happened? What happened was that the Bible was indeed translated to all the local languages in Europe, and it was printed and mass circulated, and everybody got to read the Bible, and the vast majority of people thought, my God, this is such a shitty book! This is just terrible! How many people believe in this crap? And they left the church. You cannot control technology. The guys who invent the technologies have plans. Putin started the contactor or something in Russia because he wanted the Russian Facebook and thinks he can control it. There's no way he can. That's the typical mistake of the old power structure when a new technology comes along. For example, in 1998, when I observed the internet, it was very, very easy for me to write a best-selling book claiming that the dot-com companies were frauds and would be terrible failures. Why? Because their structure was the old power structure and their dream about the new phenomenon called the internet, when in reality the only way to look at the internet was to look with fresh eyes from the outside. At the end of the day, the reason why the church lost its power in Europe wasn't because people read the Bible and found it was a crappy book. The reason why the church lost its power was because cardinals and aristocrats were sitting in the Russian countryside having fancy dinners and saying, oh, we're not going to move into those new cities where the new bourgeoisie are living. Those are horrible places. They're full of Jews and Negroes and gays. And we're not going to move there at all. That's horrible. Soon there's going to be a starvation of some kind or a fire or something, and the city's going to be, you know, it's going to disappear, and they're all going to move back to the countryside, and they're going to go to church again, and we're going to be the rulers of the world again. Never happened. Don't repeat that mistake. The problem is, when we move into a revolution like this one, into a genuine paradigm shift in human history, it's exactly those guys, those Jews and faggots and Negroes, who are despised in the cities, who are the winners. Because they're located exactly where the revolutions happen. They're lucky. And they're hungry. They're hungry. And it's the fat cats who sit around the table in the old power structure, the mass media barons. Rupert Murdoch hasn't done a single thing right with the internet. All his internet enterprises like MySpace and all these things have completely failed. Because he applies industrialist logic on the internet, which, if you read my books, he would know is absolutely wrong. You have to apply interactive logics. You have to find a new logic that works in the interactive environment, or else you're lost. Listen.
It seems like within the kind of rough history you've traced, there's also, I want to ask if you see some other kind of recursivity, because you've traced one sort of line going from spoken to interactive, but it seems to me that in this sort of interactivity that you're describing with the internet, it may not refer in the same way to the written and the mass media, but it does in many ways refer to speech.
My point in building this is that spoken language does not disappear, it's still there. On spoken language, you build written language. On written language, you build mass media, and on mass media, you build interactivity.
Right.
So what interactivity does is that it alters all the others. We will speak differently, we will write differently, we will mass produce information differently, but at the end of the day, who controls the society is the guy who's the most interactive. So what I want to get at, instead of getting too deep into theory, because the question is really interesting, is to say that be interactive is a winning formula from now on. It wasn't, now it is. So what we're looking at now is a society where we have to completely rewrite the I have to completely rewrite what it means to be a human being. I have to completely redefine what a society is. And we also have to understand that just like the cardinals and the aristocrats were the wrong guys to run a factory because they were lazy and they were fat and they didn't get it. It happened underneath their nose. Exactly the same thing is going to happen now. Rupert Murdoch and Vladimir Putin will be overrun. You are not going to city plan or be architects of a city Putin's dreams, because if you are, you'll be a terrible loser. even if you get Putin's money to do it. You need to convince the Putin guys that we need something different. That's my point. Because we're now moving into an era where I would describe the new winners, the new nectocrats, the new nectar songs, the winners of the internet world, the guys who have the power in the internet world, are social monsters. You need to be a social monster more than anything. You need to be socially intelligent. That is the number one talent you should be. And you should also hopefully be geographically located on the new map where you're hungry and on your way out. I'll give an example from Sweden. When this theory came along in 1998, I was hated by traditional sociologists. Because traditional sociologists, of course, used this era's measurements for sociology, which is income and wealth. So they were sloppy, and they, for 400 years, they've been going around measuring income and wealth. And if you measure income and wealth to find what problems are, for example, in Swedish society, you would say the underclass in our society are immigrants arriving from Somalia and Iran who live in suburbs of Stockholm and Gothenburg. And I said that's a very sloppy analysis and it's utterly wrong. Because I want empirically installed to measure the use of interactive media technologies. I think that's a much better way of measuring power in our society today. You know what? When I then went to the suburbs of Stockholm and found the Somali and Iranian immigrant children, they spoke 5 languages fluently, they had friends around the world, they had parabola antenna on top of their houses. They weren't very rich, but who cared? They were winners. Now, 12 years later, they've taken over the goddamn media industry in Scandinavia. Everywhere they look in the Scandinavian media industry today, it's completely overrepresented by immigrant children. Exactly the multicultural, curious, hungry, social monsters that I proposed would take over the world. That's exactly what's going on today in the world. We are going through exactly the same move that we did. We moved from the village to the city. We're now moving from the city to cyberspace. And in cyberspace, we're constructing a new reality, a new world. A new society that's going to control the other place. Cyberspace is controlling the city like the city controlled the village. Once power shifted from the village to the city started controlling the village to send it down. Same thing's happening now. Cyberspace is controlling the city. There will be no city planning. There will be no architecture that doesn't start in cyberspace reality. Cyberspace is reality. It's not virtual reality, it is reality. Not a single person in this room came here today without beforehand deciding online. We don't make a single decision in our lives anymore without deciding online first. Our online activity determines all our activities in physical, in the physical world. We have already moved. We are a cyberspace being. If you ask another person who you are, They point to your Facebook page. They don't point to you. I was working with a travel agency in Sweden, one of the very few travel agencies that is successful at the moment because they moved away from selling flight tickets, which you buy in 1 month, into selling consultancy services. You know what the winning formula was? They were the first traveling agency, at least that I know, that have realized that the reason why people, for example, go on holiday to Nepal, which is a very exotic country, is not to see Nepal. The main reason why people now go on holiday to Nepal is to get flashy new pictures for the Facebook page from Nepal. Hey, I've been to Nepal, and I was there with, and I was there with, and I met this person, and I met this person. That is not the main driving motor of human activity. That's how important interactivity. Why do I think these questions are important? Because I want to portray to you a relevant idea of what the world is. Because I know, for example, if you're part of building the new Moscow, South of Moscow thing, as an example, it's a very concrete example of struggle as opposed to being involved, to be honest with you. And if you're going to listen to the oligarchs and their version of the world, you're not going to build the city for those people who are going to live in it. And I think deep at heart, what you're concerned with is to build a city that the people who live in it will enjoy living in. So I'm not talking about the oligarchs here in Bedrock. I'm not interested. They have their mass media machine to tell them what they think anyway. I am trying to get you into the mode of thinking, how can I create something that's so beautiful and attractive to the people who actually consume it, who are inside it, that they're going to love me afterwards and say, thank you for building this beautiful building for me that I love. That's the dream of an architect. The dream of an architect is not to build a big penis for an oligarch, which is what the Crystal Tower was going to be. It's going to be a dead building. What they dream about, what an architect dreams about, is to be loved. Human beings dream about being loved. And the architect's dream is one of the most beautiful dreams because it's actually a very long-term dream. Architects have to fight to get their ideas through. It's one of the hardest art forms because it takes patience. It takes years and years and years and years to get your ideas through. But at the end of the day, when you lie there, you're old and you're going to die, people are going to come up to you and say, thank you for building beautiful buildings that I loved to be inside. That's the dream of the world. And that's where we need to head now. What kind of environment are these interactive social monsters going to want to be inside to feel pleasurable, to love life? Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit, actually, I'm sort of thinking about connecting back to David's talk earlier, specifically this image here. Can you talk a little bit about what you think is the role of research? Because we're in this strange moment here where we're not actually building this city. We're supposed to be kind of researching. So what sort of research do you think is necessary, and in what mode?
Beliefs. How are beliefs changing and why? What I'm telling you today is that contrary to what most people narcissistically think, their beliefs are not something they should choose. Beliefs are not something we logically reason ourselves with. Beliefs are something that is an automatic given to us depending on the technologies and the communications we use. This theory says, it's very Marxian in that sense, this theory says that the technologies we use dictate how we think, not the other way around. Meaning, the way we communicate with other human beings dictates our values, dictates our beliefs. I'm going to go into that, so I'll give you a few examples of that. What I want to do, what time is it, by the way? Is it late or late? No? Okay, good. So I want to portray the consequences of the technologies. So I told you before, what I'm saying is all bullshit unless two things. The first thing is that we need to empirically show that the amount of available information explodes once and for all, at least a million times. We have a huge information explosion. For example, with the internet. Just looking at statistical numbers and nothing else. Between January the 1st, 2008 and December 31st, 2008, humanity produced more information than we produced throughout all of human history up until the last December 2007. So, are we currently in the middle of a huge information explosion? Yes. Is this information accessible to us? Yes, very much so. More than a library ever could be. Because it's in our hands all the time. Okay, fair enough. This is a paradigm shift. This should have dramatic consequences on human society. So let's look at that. Because the other thing I said, my theory is bullshit unless it affects every important parameter of a given society. So let's look at what happened when we went from written to printed language, and what then happened when we went from mass media to interactive. For example, in the society we had in Europe in the early 1400s, this was a society driven by agriculture. You lived in the countryside. It was all about production of food. The brilliant thing with permanent settlements and written language was that you could know it. And the one thing people really did when they had written language was that they learned about plants and animals, and they learned how to tame them and domesticate them. So we could produce food, and we could produce plants, we could produce animals, and we could then consume in one place. We didn't have to move around. What happened in Iraq before the population explosion 4,000 years ago was, of course, the amount of available food exploded. Because of what happened with your permanent settlement. As long as people were nomadic, the entire population of the planet never exceeded 3 million. Because if you have to chase, hunt, and collect to survive, to eat, You cannot house more than 3 million people on the entire planet, which is not even a third of the population of current Moscow. But when you can produce food, you can house far more people. So agriculture was there. People lived in the village. The village was life. The village was society. The church, you have a big building of the oligarch who basically controlled the industry of the village. You had a factory. No, you didn't have a factory. You had farms. Sorry about that. You had farms. You had a big farm. This is the society with the village as its center. So it's all centered around the village. It's centered around land ownership. Who owns the land controls the society. This is not about social monsters. That's current society. This was a society where being smart enough to manipulate people to make sure you own the land was a winning formula. Controlling land ownership is key, because then you're also controlling agricultural production. Land ownership. That means we have an aristocracy. This is very Karl Marx. The aristocracy are opposed to the peasants. The peasants working for the aristocrats to make a living. The aristocrats are literally the guys who own land are the rulers. Land ownership rule, aristocracy. And peasants are the people who basically are the serfs for the aristocrats. Then you need the metaphysics. Each given society in history has had its own form of metaphysics. And metaphysics changes when the basic conditions for a society change. That's very, very important, because metaphysics is the driving force of people's behavior, beliefs. Very much beliefs. So what was the foundation for beliefs in Europe in early 1400s before the printing press came around? This was a society the historians wrote about Adam and Eve. The church paid them the bills, right? What kind of metaphysical truths do you have in that kind of society? Well, we have a society based on God. The idea is that there is a God. Nomadic tribes have their own rule fathers and rule mothers. But once the nomadic tribes stopped killing each other and started to collaborate, because they lived along the same river and they were building villages, and they started to trade with each other and exchanging husbands and wives with each other, they couldn't kill each other anymore. And the only way to not kill each other anymore is to decide that, oh, we don't need rule fathers and rule mothers anymore. We have one rule father for all tribes who are living all along the villages of this river. In other words, monotheism was invented. And we see exactly the same thing. Monotheism is constantly invented and spread with permanent settlements around the river deltas of the world, starting 5,000 years ago. There's not a single trace of monotheism before that. It's an idea whose time has come. It works here. And around God, we can build a complete metaphysical system. This is a system of religion. Religion unites people. You're a Catholic, or you're a Protestant, or you're some other religion, you're a Muslim, whatever. But your religion defines who you are. It gives you your social identity. Religion is very, very important in this type of society. Who produces the truth? The truth producer here is, of course, the church itself, because it pays the historians to write about Adam and Eve. The Bible is the only source of truth. Or the Quran, which I would prefer, because they have more fun. But anyway, this is driven by what kind of payment do you get for people behaving in a good way? What kind of payment do peasants get from aristocrats for behaving as the aristocrats want them to behave? They get eternity. When you die, you're going to go to heaven. And in heaven, everything will be cool, you don't have to work anymore, and there'll be food all the time, drink, and whatever. The Christian heaven is kind of boring. You play the harp. No, the Muslim heaven is all full of alcohol and sex. I would prefer that. I'm definitely Muslim in Jose. This is a society also where the beliefs, we talked about the beliefs, you were into that, are what we would call religious morality. The religious morality. In other words, beliefs are down to God. Somebody met God once, God spoke to that person briefly, that person came down a mountain, had with him 10 commandments. Those 10 commandments you have to obey. If you don't obey them, you're not going to go to heaven. Religious morality. So the value systems in that kind of society are religious morality. For example, if a man sleeps with another man, we kill him. If he sleeps with a woman, they have to marry and have children, because God wants it that way. You don't question that. You can't question that if you live in a society where God is the only metaphysical constant. And that was the case. This was never questioned. There was no instrument to question it with. But the printing press brought in a multicultural society, in a way. It brought in heterogeneity. It brought on different poles of discourse. industry took over as the driving force of the economy. Suddenly, 5% of the population got into agriculture, which started to look more and more like factories. And instead, the vast majority of the population moved into cities to work in factories, because we had more information available. A person who can read and write can work in a factory. A person who can't read and write cannot work in a factory. There's not a single example of industrialism happening anywhere on the planet in a society where there isn't widespread literacy first. That's exactly why the industrialists were the guys who invented in schools in the early 19th century to educate people to read and write so they could work in factories. Because factory work is more complex than agricultural work. Again, the way we communicate, the communication technologies we use, determine how we behave, and our behavior determines how we think, not the other way around. We have industry. We leave the village and move into the city. The aristocrats and the cardinals were having their dinners. But at the same time, the new elite were having their dinners inside the cities, and they were taking over. This society where money is the driving force. My dad grew up in this society. My dad would read the tax book before he went to bed at night, comparing his income with other men's income. The guy who is the richest when he dies wins, became the new winning formula. Social status. The guy who has the most money gets the most beautiful wife. Russian oligarchy. Other guys are beautiful women. Yeah, makes sense. It worked. All the industrialists in the 19th century in Europe were like that. Russia's just catching up. Money is the driving force here. We have a new elite, what Karl Marx called the bourgeoisie. They're opposed to workers who they have to fool to stay inside the factory 16 hours a day for very little pay. That's the new power structure. You can see how all the constants are changing. And a new metaphysics. We need a new metaphysics. The church was not involved in building factories. It was stuck in the countryside. The bourgeoisie, to take over and control and rule society, had also to come up with a new metaphysical system. Even though the printing press was first invented in Germany in the 1450s, it really exploded in use in the 17th century in France. France was the first country where the printing press really became a mass instrument of control. And we all know that in France in the 17th century, you had the Enlightenment philosophers. And the Enlightenment philosophers were very popular with the bourgeoisie because they dictated a whole new metaphysics. They didn't say that God was dead, because if they said that God is dead, they probably had their heads chopped off. They were smarter than that. The trick here, when you construct a new metaphysics, is not to actually say the old one is so bad, but rather say the old one is irrelevant. Remember my use of the word irrelevant before? I don't want to offend people unnecessarily. I don't want to offend Putin, you know. I just want to tell somebody else that something's going on under Putin's nose that Putin's not aware of, and that's more interesting than Putin himself. So what did Voltaire and Descartes and these other guys say? Well, they needed to get rid of God. They needed to get God out of the equation to formulate a new metaphysics without God. And the way to do it was to put God to sleep. They said, well, since God is perfect, he's done what he's supposed to do. He's no longer relevant. You know, the world is running without God. We don't need God in the equation. And then Descartes came up with the most famous one-liner from the 17th century. He formulated and said, I think, therefore I am. Please note which word is absent from that sentence. I think, therefore I am. Where do you find the word God? It's not there. God's been put to sleep. But another word pops up twice in that sentence, making it tough to logic. I think, therefore I am. This is a new religion, a new metaphysics. This is the idea of the individual, of the human being as the center of the universe, as the single human being as the center of the universe. This is the invention of the individual. The word individual is not used anywhere before France in the 17th century. It's an innovation. It's a new concept. It's a metaphysical concept. It's just like the $100 bill is not really worth $100. We're just pretending that it is. We are pretending we are individuals, but we're not. I have never found an individual in my life. I've never met an individual. I never did. I know there are 7 million billion bodies on this planet who are fooled to believe they're individuals, and that's a very different thing for being individuals. I have never met an individual in my life. Have you? Just like nobody ever met God. Well, there was this guy who met somebody who was on fire in a mountain sometime That's it. But the trick to do really good metaphysics is to do something that doesn't exist. Or that can't be proved to exist. Because then you get rid of it. That's exactly what an individual is. It's a beautiful concept. It was so useful. And the reason why we started to believe in the idea of the individual was that we were all becoming bourgeois and we were flattered because it fitted so perfectly into our idea of what it meant to be a human being. That's exactly how an idea is being spread and becomes popular. It flatters people. It flatters precisely those people who pay the checks. It flatters those people who have the power. So in other words, if an idea becomes very widespread, it reveals what the power structure looks like. It reveals who has the power. Who would be flattered by this idea? Oh, the Orthodox priest would be flattered by this idea. Or, no, the industrialist would be flattered by this idea. Or, David Erickson would be flattered by this idea. It reveals who pays the checks, who's got the power. And that's what we're interested in. Where is power in this story? That's why the idea of individualism spread so fast. Not because it was true or right, but because it was popular with the new holders of power who were generated by new technology and who could build cities that actually functioned. People didn't die anymore because you had much more information available because of the printing press. There's not a single example of a city in Europe that could grow on its own before 1898. Not until the late 19th century can we finally construct cities that are so complex and work that they don't actually kill the people who move into them. Before then, everybody's fooled to move to cities and then they die. The vast majority die. Because they're horrible places to live. Unhygienic, killing machines. So, we put God to sleep and thereby we kill the old metaphysics. And instead we get a new metaphysics, the metaphysics of our parents. And this is a metaphysics built on nationalism. A new social identity. We build nation states. We build Russia. And Russia, and France, and Sweden, and China, and India, and America. We build all these different nation states with flags. And we are Americans, Russians, Prussians, French, whatever. That's the society we live in. Is anybody here in this room prepared to die for their country? Seriously, are you prepared to die for your country? No, you're not, because you're interactive. That's evidence that my theory is true. It's correct. Because 50 years ago, you would have thrown up your hands and said, yeah, I would die for my country. 50 years ago, you would have. You absolutely would have. That's exactly why you have these huge world wars where people die like flies. Because they were prepared to die for their nations. Nobody is anymore. Why? Because nationality is irrelevant. It's not interesting. It's not interesting at all. Who produces truth? The experts. And where are the experts? The university doctors. They're men in shabby clothing who get paid by the bourgeoisie to write a history about Stonehenge. And they sit on TV and their own radio shows and they're experts. Who's the expert these days? Well, I work with television in Sweden, and we don't get any of these experts on television anymore because they're boring to look at and we don't have an alternative. So if, for example, you have this TV show, a news show, you got to explain something new in depth, like the Greek crisis, how did it come about? You bring in a 17-year-old beautiful girl with blonde hair. And she picks up her cell phone, and she's got a Wikipedia. And she reads from Wikipedia and says, Greece, this is the economy of Greece, this is how it works. And you look at her bosoms and you listen to what she says, and it's exactly like the expert from the university would have said it, only even better, and it looks great. The expert is no longer a human being. The expert is the damn smartphone. The machine is the expert. We don't need to be experts anymore because we've outsourced that. We have let our brains shrink even more and put that knowledge outside of our bodies. In the late 1970s, when I went to school in Sweden, there was a big uproar because they introduced a reform. And we were going to use electronic calculators in maths class. And people were terribly upset about this. What do you mean? The kids are going to be able to use electronic calculators when they do math tests? Well, there's no way they can ever learn a multiplication table that way. And I was thinking, you know, once these electronic calculators are in our hands, they're probably going to stay there for the rest of our lives, and with the next generation, and so on and so forth. They're probably going to be with humanity forever from now on. So why don't people realize that a maths test is no longer a test of whether you know the multiplication table in your head? Rather, a maths test is now a test on how to use an electronic calculator. I was a kid, and I was questioning my parents, and I realized they don't get it. I think the world is full today of questions of, my parents don't get it. Everything today is my parents don't get it. It's constantly this idea that it's scary that information is all over in our heads, that it's actually stored in our smartphone. But who cares if the smartphone's going to be with me for the rest of my life? It's actually an integral part of who I am. A human being is no longer only the body. A human being is a human body with a smartphone from now on. There is soon not a single person on this planet who is not having a smartphone with them that they regard as personal and as integral with who they are as their penis and vagina. It's an extension of the body that's permanent. That's how powerful this technology is.
Alexander, can I ask you a question, please?
Yeah.
You spoke about experts being paid by oligarchs to become the attractive version of history. Well, aren't you one, like right now? What would be the difference, like the structural difference?
We're going to go into the new paradigm, and I'm serving the new paradigm.
Exactly, but
I'm paid by the netocrats to come here today.
I'm expecting you to put yourself on the blank page.
Yeah. I'm a whore. I'm traveling around the world giving these lectures, and I get paid to do them. And I get paid to do them precisely because I preach to the netocrats like yourself. You are the new holders of power. You are the new elite. And you have to behave responsibly. That's my purpose to be here. You can be a really obnoxious elite if you want to. Some people will try that. But my recommendation is that to love yourself a little better, feel good about yourself the day you die, maybe you should be a sweet elite and nice and take care of people who are left behind. Because not all young kids in Russia are fortunate enough to go to the Strelka Institute and meet guys like me. Almost kids are not even online in Russia. And it's your purpose in your life to support them. That's why. We get it. Okay, values. No longer eternity. But another idea. What did you teach to workers in factories and keep them in check? You teach them progress. The idea of progressive linear thinking. The world would constantly be better. Your children are going to be better off than you are if you only behave. What Putin tells Russians to. That's the old message. That's the metaphysics of progress rather than eternity. Progressivity, the idea that history progresses in leaps and comes constantly more beautiful and more noble, stone, bronze, iron, feathering, you know, that kind of history, right? Which we, of course, don't believe in anymore. Now, we're going on then. But progress is there, and values and belief systems here I would identify as secular but moral. Secular morality. In other words, morality is values that always start with a patriarch. With a judge, with the idea that there's somebody there who knows more than we do. So we're not capable of judging for ourselves. The only difference is that with religious morality, values are all referring to a god, supposedly who the cardinal has met once. And the cardinal has a book in Latin, and the cardinal preaches from the book and tells us how we should behave to be loved by God so we can get to heaven. That's a religious morality. The morality here changes, but it's still morality. It's still the idea that there's a judge. But the judge is rather a Napoleon, or a Stalin, or a Lenin, or somebody else. It's a man, and he's probably old, with a beard, and he tells you how to behave, and if you don't behave that way, he's going to be nasty to you, and lock you up and treat you bad. Secular morality. But it's values that you don't question. It's orders you're being given, because the machine looks this way. It's the only way values can be. Values cannot be produced bottom-up in this kind of society. They have to be produced top-to-bottom, because it's the only means of communication. Parts of the world where nation-states did not develop fell apart and were colonized and conquered until they became nation-states. Because unless you formulate a nation-state and structure a nation-state, you cannot control people, and you cannot build a society. You cannot build industries. So, all these variables should now change. Industry. countries these days. They're probably in Bangladesh and southern China. A couple of them in Ukraine. They're in places of not very high relevance to the world map. Because industry is no longer the driving force. Industry is manufacturing things that somebody else puts a brand on. If you buy a bottle of mineral water, you pay €2 for it. About 2 cents is for the water. The other €1.19 you pay for it are media costs. Media has taken over and controlled the world. We live in a medium-sized world. Whether it's mass media, the old media, or the new media, the social media, the internet, it's all media now. If you ask 70-year-olds today where they want to be in the future, they will always give you an abstract answer, putting them in front of or behind a camera, a microphone, recording equipment, and a computer. That is where power is now. That's where the world is going on. That's where things are moving. And whatever happens there controls everything else. So we need a new metaphysics that defines the world from a cyberspace perspective, looking at physical reality, rather than from physical reality, looking at a cyber perspective. Otherwise, we get it wrong. We start asking the wrong questions and we do bad research. We need to put ourselves here, away from our parents, in the cyber world. And look at the world from the cyber world and say that the cyber world is the only world that's real. Whatever is out there in terms of the physical world is secondary. So we observe it from this position. Then we start asking the next question. Right. So cyberspace takes over from city. Your parents walked around with little cards in their hands that said their name, their postal address, and possibly a phone number and a fax number. Those cards are now gone. Because as soon as we know another person, then you know, we can always go to Facebook and add them or send them a message. We don't use cards anymore because we live in the cyber world. The physical address is dead. Post offices around the world are closing down fast. They're becoming redundant. We've already moved. This is a world driven not by money, but by attention. Not by money? Exactly. Not by money. By attention. Attention is originally French word, attention. And the way we construct it is that we take credibility times awareness and multiply it two. This is the new equation without any dollar or ruble or euro signs. This is the equation of power. This is the equation you have to put yourself and your friends inside if you're going to determine if you have any influence, if you have any power in the new society. Because everything now is driven by attention. Exactly because starting a Facebook page costs nothing. It's all about imagination, technological, sociological know-how. It costs nothing. So, looks this way. If it's a multiplying relationship, you put it on an axis, to credibility here and awareness here. Do people know that you exist? Is the question here. And if they know that you exist, what kind of value do they attach to you? Do they like you or do they dislike you? Do they want to be your friend or do they despise you or want to keep you at a distance? That's credibility. These two things determine everything. They determine if you add somebody or if you ignore them on Facebook. They determine whether you buy something or whether you don't buy it. They determine whether you like the brand or whether you dislike it. They determine whether you get a job or you don't get a job. They even determine whether you get laid or not when you go out in a club on a Friday night. What do you think of before you go out to a club on a Friday night? You think of, are people going to know that I'm there? And are going to be attracted to me? Attention. You don't think about how much money do I have in my pocket. Because you know if you're attracted to people, they're going to pay your drinks. Money goes to the people who have the attention. Look at a Google page. Look at a Google page. You should have. Can I just carry this there? Something behind it. We'll go there. Google page. Google is the closest we get to Bible of the internet. It's the most frequently used page on the web. And it's structured this way. It has two sections. One section that occupies 80% of the space and another section that occupies 20% of the space. When you go to the left column, the big one, it's all measured as AT, credibility times awareness. It's attentional value. interesting, too old-fashioned, too traditional, too irrelevant for us to care about them. But they probably have enough money to pay Google to at least get a little space on the Google page in the right corner. You know what the really scary thing is? This is how Google have constructed it to sell it to people so people buy to have their name in the right column. When we look at the traffic generated, it looks very different. When we look at the traffic generated, over 98.5% of traffic goes here. And less than 1.5% of traffic goes to the right column. Empirically, this means that already today in 2011, and this is a development that gets stronger and stronger every month, already in 2011, only 1.5% of internet traffic is directed by money flows. 98.5% of what goes on the internet is created by attentional flows. Very often, a 17-year-old Korean schoolgirl with her blog is far more influential than the marketing head of Coca-Cola in America. This is a very different world from 30 years ago, isn't it? What is happening is that this is being killed. And what happens is that these guys communicate with each other, creating huge information flows that we then build our social media functions, Twitter or Facebook, where we then get our information, which we regard as our deepest sense of knowledge in our lives. It's in the smartphone. Because we're not communicating directly with others. What then happens is that it's here, in this segment, that we have to look at the new power structure, that we look at where decisions are being made, that we have to look at the people who we are going to ask, how do you want to live before we plan a city? Or before we make a drawing for a house. These are the people we need to ask. Not these people. We have to fool these people to pay for us to learn that we should ignore them. That's why you're at Stroke. You're being paid to go here to learn how to ignore the people who pay you to be here. That's a revolution. That's what a revolution is. Revolutions always were. The king is always fat and tired, sitting in his castle, thinking nothing's going on, while we are out there on the streets, networking, saying, we're going to do a revolution, we're going to start Tuesday at 4 o'clock, and we're going to shock the king, and we're going to shock the TV station, and the radio station, and I don't know what, because we've got Twitter in our hands, and ooh, Gaddafi's dead! Gaddafi died, it took a few months. We Twitter. In Libya. Not America, but Libya. That's how fast things are changing. Now you know who's going to pay you to become a citizen. Who you have to respect, who you have to listen to, whose information you have to take, whose knowledge you have to share, who you have to serve to get paid. The network. We're creating a new upper class of social monsters, and we have to define this middle class. And we have a new underclass online. Everybody's online. No people are excluded. Everybody soon has smartphones and online. In 1998, I went through the Indian state of Andhra Pradesh and discovered already in 1998 that every village in Andhra Pradesh had internet connections for free for the citizens. Only half the villages had running water. Because building running water costs money, the internet is for free. Because the internet wants to expand. All the actors on the internet are actively investing in the internet because the more it spreads, the more useful it becomes, the more of a weapon it is. That's exactly why the internet is exploding around the world. And even the poorest countries on the planet are using it. For example, the first country in the world to develop a mass technology where you use mobile phones as payments, so you don't even need credit cards, is Kenya. There are no credit cards in Kenya because they're smarter than we are. They got rid of the credit cards and they just used their mobile phones.
May I add paid for by Vodafone?
Yes, it's a smart card.
I'm there.
Do you see what I mean? new technological innovations are going to jump up all of a sudden in the weirdest places. Because all of a sudden you have hungry people who you totally disregarded, and with your racist prejudices, you would judge them as totally inferior, irrelevant before, and now they're the most innovative people on the planet. Fishermen in Kerala invented the world's first system for finding out the price of your goods before you go to the market. Because they were sitting on their boats outside Kerala coast and thinking, I can either take up another ton of shrimp, or I can go into the harbor and sell the shrimp already caught, depending on the price. They used their mobile phones, and they made their decisions. And they're far more wealthy than they were 10 years ago, as a result of that technology, which they're now selling, by the way, to the rest of the world. It's a very different world. Consumptarians, who are they? Consumptarians, in Western Europe at least, are mostly middle-aged, overweight, unmarried men who are unemployed, and socially dysfunctional. They go online occasionally, they try to add people on Facebook but are being ignored because they're boring and nobody wants to communicate with them, and they end up porn surfing. I defined them in 1998, I was laughed at in Sweden, then the Sweden Democrats came into parliament and people started realizing that the Sweden Democrats, the racist part in Sweden, which is not a parliament, are exactly the people I warned about 15 years ago. And that's their only revenge they've got left, is to try to get into parliament so they can say how much they hate everybody else because they're left behind. Your job is to find the consumptarians wherever you live and support them. That is always the job of a socially responsible human being. Who are the underclass in your society? Is it the people with a low income and low wealth? No! It's the people who are left behind on the internet. The guys who go online and don't get to grips with it. Who are not social monsters, who have problems with being social. They're the guys we need to support. That's where political activism should be today. We no longer regard nationality as important. The people are willing to live and die for their subcultural identities. If you work at Vodafone and Vodafone, you know exactly what this means. It means that the strongest social identity with young people today is their subcultural identity. I work in the music industry, this is absolutely key. The biggest, strongest, most popular artists today are not the artists with the best songs or the greatest performances, it's the artists who create a social identity for their fans. So you feel like you're following the artist, you're in that artist community, you might even meet your future husband or wife in that community. Providing people with an excuse to be social is the key to be successful. This is exactly why everybody's obsessed with creating and trying to maintain communities online. Because running your own community online successfully will make you the ultimate power broker in this society. You will be extremely powerful if you have followers to your community. Then you're a winner. Then you're an expert. And getting access to those followers, becoming friends with them, joining their community, supporting that community, to then build your own sub-community, is then the strategy you need to use. This is a world completely controlled by the web. We no longer go to universities to find the truth. And it's the bloggers on the web who are the new producers of truth. Their version of events is key. The biggest bloggers on the internet today who do design. For example, I write music. I did a TV show this week. And I met a music critic from Sweden's biggest newspaper, who was on the same show. And he asked me, he was supposed to ask me a question, and he asked me a very good question. He asked me, do you read my reviews of your music? And I said, well, I don't want to offend you, but actually I don't, because you've become irrelevant. There are about 150 music blogs in Sweden that are far more important in spreading my music than you are. Because nobody cares about a music critic who works at a newspaper anymore. Because working for a newspaper is old and boring and not interactive. Whereas the music bloggers who constantly communicate with the readers are far more interactive. It's in the music blog environment that the opinion of a certain piece of music is being graded today. Online, like everything else. This is a new metaphysic. We don't have time for progress anymore. We don't believe it. You don't go to work for a company because it's growing so many percentages per year. You couldn't care less. What young people today are looking for is what Jacques Derrida in the 1960s called development. The event. The sins that you are in a place, that you are located virtually within a context where it feels like things are happening. The Strelka Institute becomes successful if you go out of here after 1 year and tell everybody else it was a wonderful year at the Strelka Institute, where you met a lot of new friends, and you're going to stay in touch with the rest of your life, where you started your new homepage and your new blog, where you told everybody what you think of city planning for the future. That was your great year at Strelka. And if you then become an ambassador of Strelka, Strelka will become a successful subculture, and Strelka will become an event. Because we're all now event-driven. What we're looking for is that we have this enormous space called cyberspace. When we go online, there's only millions and millions of pages to go to. So which ones do we go to? We go to the ones where we feel that's where things are happening that involve me. That is exactly a philosophical distinction. That's chapter Dawes' distinction of what modern human beings are looking for the event. And this means it forces us to put the individual to sleep, to get rid of the currency. I think, therefore, I am, with its linear thinking. Because the new human being here is the DVGL. Individual is Latin, meaning penultimate, solid, individual, undivided. You cannot divide something. It's a human being with a soul and a body that forever is there. Solid, cannot be destroyed or altered. We don't believe in that anymore. We believe in constant alterations, we believe in constant changes, we believe in the element of surprise and enjoying surprise. We love to change because people love us online if we change. It's not that we chose, we didn't choose to be extroverted, we didn't choose to be multicultural, we didn't choose to be heterogeneous. We didn't choose to be in constant flux and change. Our friends forced us to. For the simple reason that we do not entertain them, and they don't want to be friends with us, and they don't want to build communities and networks with us, involving us, unless we become these constantly changing people. And if you're in constant change, you are not an individual. This is the exact opposite of the Cartesian idea of individual. Or you would be the same thing all through your life. This is a human being, a body, in constant flux. Gilles Deleuze, another philosopher, formulated that in 1982 when he wrote for the first time about the division, the dividable human being, the human being with many persona. Persona is Greek for face. Many persons within a body. A person is a face. It's a front that others can see. And we are now changing faces all the time. We have lots of different faces. Very often we have different accounts. We have several Facebook accounts, several Twitter accounts. We're one person at work, we're another person at Strelka, we're the third person with our parents, we're the fourth person with our friends, we're the fifth person we go online, we're the sixth person we go cruising for sex. You know, we're all these different people inside the same body. We're schizophrenic. Schizophrenia is a winning. Yeah.
Okay, so we know that these time spaces are overlapping. And here at Strelka, the way we have our research areas divided, actually, they overlap. These spaces overlap. You have the hinterland, the megacity, and this other stuff, citizens as customers, and the next one coming up, sensible cities. So I'm really interested in what you understand to be the interaction between these spaces, because...
Lovely question. Perfect question. That's exactly why pedagogically look at the old paradigm shift. Because the first question I always got when I started presenting this was like, well, how about food? I didn't say food becoming irrelevant. I was just saying that food is not something you go out and you've tamed yourself a plant or a pig, and then you milk the food out of it. Food is something where you go to a shop, in the supermarket, and you pick it up, and it's frozen by specialists. Because it's become industrialized. It's still there. Now, this is where we're going to end up today. I want you to rethink the concept of the city in exactly the same way. your physical address in the sense of living somewhere is of course necessary and important because you're still a physical body that has to be disposed of somewhere. Put inside an apartment of some kind, a hotel room, whatever, where it can be fed, where it can sleep, where it can wake up, where it can have its breakfast, you know, all those things. But because we're now looking at the world from here, which is what I'm training you to do, we look at the city not from here, and certainly not from here, but we're looking at the city from here. So what will the city as a concept be like if it's looked at from cyberspace? It will be very, very different. I'll give you a concrete example. Most modern cities today are still constructed according to the principle that people go to work 5 to 6 days a week. They leave a home, transport themselves somehow, publicly or on their own, to a workplace where they spend 5 to 6 days a week. You're obliged to construct cities that way. It's a terrible mistake. It's like building history on the Stone Age. Because people don't live that way anymore. And they're going the other direction. The average person in the Western world today who goes to work, 3.8 days a week. That means they're already not going to work at least 1.2 days a week. Meaning they work on the move. They work at home, and they work on the move with their smartphones and their laptops. Because work is becoming virtualized. Now wait a second. If that's the movement, we're going from 5 to 6 days towards 3.8 days now, that movement is not going to reverse. Just like the electronic calculator is not going to go away. That movement is going to expand. We're going to go towards 2.5, 2 days a week at work. Maybe even to 0 days a week at work. And if that happens, why the hell would we build suburbs in inner cities? That's idiotic! We have to go and ask the people of the future. We have to fantasize. What would we like to live in, say, 2030, when Putin has been gone for at least 10 years? And think, what will Moscow be like in 2030? What kind of people will live there? How will they relate to reality? When they don't even go to work anymore, where they don't go back and forth? Well, to begin with, the integrated living, where you work and live at the same time, is definitely going to boom. We're going to be traveling more than ever. That means the idea of the hotel and the apartment are now becoming redundant. Look at hybrids between hotel and apartment. A lot of you have iPads here. What is the iPad? Is that a genial idea? No, it's a logical idea. It's the idea that smartphones are important, laptops are important. Laptops are powerful but clumsy. Smartphones are very easy to use but not very powerful. Let's do something in between. Boom! You've got a boom product. It's the same thing here. Hybrid living. Why would I live in a hotel if hotels are impersonal? Why would I live in an apartment when it ties me up in a geographic space when I'm constantly on the move? Oh, we'll give you the hybrid in between the two. Boom. It's when you think these practical ways, and you think like that, think of your generation, what are going to be your needs 10, 15 years from now? You're the Korean schoolgirls. Okay? And your younger siblings, and possibly your children. What kind of world are they going to live in? What kind of needs are they going to have? What kind of world do they want to live in? We can talk about Deleuzean architecture, for example. It's just doing, for example, nobody who plans a pathway anymore in a garden does so in a drawing. What you do is that you make them long, complete long. You leave it like that for a year. You let people use the garden. And you come back a year later and realize, oh, that's how people walk through this garden to get from A to B. Okay, then put the pathway. That's called immersion architecture. That's letting people through their behavior decide how the space is being used. That's a very modern way of thinking. David is even more an expert of this than I am. But that's just the beginning of thinking interactivity. Interactivity is basically to provide people with tools that they can use so they feel they're being part of creation. It's give them, okay, here's a wall, here's a foundation, here's a roof. You do what you want. far more attractive than getting the finished house for an interactive person. And this is how we have to think city planning and architecture for now. Yeah?
I have a question. You invite us to look at the city from the cyberspace. But judging from 1, 2, 3, and 4, the space and time between those stages shrinks. So the time between 1 and 2 is much bigger than between 3 and 4. Wouldn't it be right to suppose that interactive stage will be much shorter? Is it smart to look at the city from the cyberspace? Or maybe it's more interesting to see what number 5 could be, because this will come very soon.
Well, you're missing out on something I told you at the beginning. I told you, forget about Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age. You're not going to have the fifth communication technology on top to keep the ecosystem relevant. Whenever there is a paradigm shift, if it ever occurs, and that's very likely, I agree, probably sooner than we think, well, then we're going to kill the whole system and look at the world with new eyes. Because that's what we always did. The Stone Age only existed to present industrialism as relevant. The Stone Age did not exist in feudal society. The church never talked about the Stone Age. The church talked about Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. So all of history is reconstructed when there's a paradigm shift. So we cannot look into the future and say there's going to be a fifth communication revolution.
So you don't have an idea about numbers.
I'll tell you, one of my favorite quotes.
You should have an idea.
No, because philosophy is the art of humbleness. And Michelle, it's true. To think good, think within your limitations. Michel Foucault said, Michel Foucault is one of my favorite 20th century philosophers. Michel Foucault said, any guy who believes he can think outside of the society he lives in is a complete idiot. We can only think with the tools we have available. And we have all the tools available. And I'll tell you all, this revolution is so profound and so important that we should concentrate on understanding it instead of trying to look in the other directions. That is the only thing I can tell you for sure. But we cannot overrate the impact of the and how it affects everything. I didn't even know when I started 30 years ago in English. I had no idea. I thought I was talking about the internet and new technologies and how you use them successfully, all those things that are like cliches today. This is how you become a successful Facebook user. I had no idea I would speak at the World Conference of City Planning in Porto Alegre in 2007. Mm-hmm. I did. Why? Because all city planners of the world realized the internet is the most dramatic single effect on city planning we have in the world today. Because it totally redirects people's lives. If people's lives, and thereby their beliefs and values, are totally redirected, that means they will want something very, very different from what we have today. That's the only thing we know for sure. Now we need to creatively start guessing what kind of world do they need then? What kind of world do they want? How can we construct a city that is in itself interactive? Yeah.
2 minutes.
Oh, okay. More questions? It's called network dynamics. It's something we've studied since the 1990s. It's now becoming a huge era within sociology, network dynamics. How do you successfully network with other people? What happens? The problem with networks is this. Because networks cost nothing to start. It costs you nothing to start a mailing list. It costs you nothing to open a Facebook forum. All these things are now more or less for free. All it takes is time and innovation. A little guts, and then you can start. That's what Korean school learners are better at this than marketing heads at Coca-Cola. The problem is this. Once you start a network, it's going to be in fierce competition with other networks. Because the one thing that's really rare is time. People are busy. You need to keep their attention to be successful. How do you keep their attention? You keep their attention by being entertaining and informative. The two things people are looking for in other human beings. How can this person entertain me? How can this person teach me something? Only that will keep my attention. The problem is this then. If you have a network and it starts to grow, that network will grow and grow and grow unless you start controlling it. Because if it grows too much, it becomes too much information, people start leaving. And the key people will be the first people to leave. because it'll go to other smaller networks that are more efficient. So you need to keep the network really, really steadfast, and you need to control it really, really well. Otherwise, it won't work. It won't stay successful. And then the problem is, if somebody pays you to get inside the network, right? That's what people do. They try to pay their way into things, like they do the Google. If they pay you to get inside the network, they're going to do one or two things. They're either going to babble too much, and everybody's going to turn around to you and say, who let this guy in? You did, and you let him in only because he paid you. We're leaving. Because people hate that. Or he's going to stay there and not do anything. He's going to lurk. The verb lurk, to lurk, is to go inside the network and just eavesdrop on others in our project. And when people discover that's going on, they're going to leave. Because they hate to feel abused. So the problem is that you cannot bring people with money inside networks. And because they're not inside networks, you cannot make money from them. But there is an interesting following question to your question, which you have to touch on. And it is, how do we get at this? Well, it goes with these guys. It goes with these guys. Because if you pay to be in the right column of Google, and it doesn't give you the results you have, you have to leave the market and send away all your ideas, everything you have, to the guys at the top of Google and Apple. So the attentionalist wins. That's why nectocrats also become wealthy. That's a side product of their behavior. That's not the goal. Google is the perfect example. In the year 2000, when the autocracy came out, when nectocrats became our leaders for the first time, I constantly get asked this question, can you please name drop a few nectocrats? Because the sloppy journalists always ask that. And I was smart enough to say, no, there are none. I'm talking about the future. Oh, please, please, no, there are not. Well, how about Bill Gates? No, Bill Gates is manufacturing physical products sold in shops. He's an industrialist. Bill Gates is not a minerator. 2005, fast forward. A Russian and an American. Larry Page is already starting. I can finally name drop two enterprises. Because Google works exactly that way. Google operates on attentional economics. There's not a single penny involved anywhere. They spend money freely on all those things because they don't have to care about it because they know the ones that are running after them anyway. The right columnist, the right to pay for it. That's how attentional economics works. So the food from the countryside came to the city, was repackaged in factories, and then 10 times higher price that was put on it before it was put in the supermarket. So the money for the food did not end up with the farmers or even the aristocrats. The money for the food, once you bought it in a Moscow supermarket, ended up with an industrialist who made food industry. The same thing happens now. So money ends up with the network. You will become financially successful if you have a big blob of many followers in your social network, because people will throw money at you to just get a tiny bit of attention on your page. That's how you make money.
What happens when guys from the right column pay to the guys in the left column?
Then the guys from the left column fall. On the left column, because they lose, yes, they lose the credibility. They're worse. They're worse. You know exactly. You go on Google, you Google to find something on the internet, and you find a great web page which you love, and you bookmark it because it's full of information, it's relevant to you, and it's got people there that you want to communicate with, that you make friends with. So you come back there again and again. It's one of your favorite web pages. And all of a sudden you discover, oh, now that web page is full of ads. Oh. And the people I wanted to meet here that I met before have left? Oh, maybe I shouldn't be here anymore. And then you start looking for them, and you go to Facebook friends. And you and I used to both go to this forum before, where, you know, well, I left because there were so many ads, and they were whores, and they paid people. So I left to this place. And then you go to another place, and then you leave. So what happens is, if you start throwing this into there, you make it dirty, and it will go down.
But I'm talking about, let's say you buy an identity, so someone, a person of trust, a blogger, and there are cases when you pay him to promote a particular product.
Then he loses his readers. Then he loses his readers. That's what bloggers do all the time. That's the hard lesson they learn. They have to minimize advertising. They have to put it in a very solid place. They have to tell people it's advertising, which is what Google do. Google never hide that this is advertising. They say screaming, advertise. People are paid to be here. We're Google whores. And we reserve only this for this to guarantee that this is totally attention. To guarantee the quality of the information provided, which is absolutely key because Google are competing with other search motors. that could be you any time if they get sloppy. You know?
What your comment would be on Apple and their latest feature, Siri, that gets rid of red home at all and gives you the right search?
Well, I don't look at the right column anyways, it doesn't disturb me. I'm going to start asking myself, why do they do that? Where do they get the money back from me then? Because what I like about the Google page is there's nothing suspicious about it. And that's an asset in potentials. I'm not saying we can't get paid. We're all getting paid. How can we survive getting paid? I'm just saying we should be very honest about it. What you're talking about, this is how I make my money. I leave my life as a social media. Monster. I spend most of the time every day communicating with friends, doing creative, fun things together with them. Everything I do in my life is either about entertainment or about knowledge, because those are the two things that I thrive on. As a human being, I love entertainment and I love knowledge. I love to grow as a human being and I love to entertain. Those are two things that drive me. If I live with somebody, it's because they have those two qualities in my eyes. But, of course, I need to make a living, so I do this and this and this and this. For example, I go around the world and give lectures. I come to Stroke Institute. They don't pay me much, but I do it because I love meeting my students so I can interact with them. Because it gives me something back that I can then take to the next lecture. Because then I usually come to a German company and they don't understand anything, so they have to pay me lots of money. Because then I'm a right column person, I'm a woman. And I tell them, I say, you don't get it. I'm not going to get anything out of you for talking here today. And I've flown into Frankfurt to speak to you today for 2 hours, and you're going to pay me for it. Because that's the benefit for me being here. That's just good communication. That's just good, honest communication. And you can never lose by being good and honest on the internet. Don't fake things. Be real, 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 real. Say things exactly as they are, as you perceive them, and go back to people. Because do you know what the benefit is of doing good, proper, honest communication? You get a good, proper, honest reply, which you can do. And this is all about the pleasure of co-creating a world together with your friends. If you like co-creating a new world together with your friends, then you are really good in the job research. Yeah?
It's not told the message
of
the as to privacy is an invention, privacy.
How do you see privacy? I don't think it is an invention. I think the idea of private and public are changing very much. But we need both for some reason. And this is just down to psychology. Psychologists will tell you that as a human being, you have these internal needs for the private and the public. The private essential is to keep to yourself and your close knit family, and you don't want other people to see from it. Some people like to walk naked down the street, they don't consider that private. Other people think that's very offensive, so they put their clothes on when they walk down the street, and they would never dream of showing themselves nude to other people. We just have different ideas of private and public. The only thing I can say for certain, because this is not my area of internet sociology, but it's something that's being studied. And it's very, very interesting, very useful. Because we know for sure that in the middle of this paradigm shift, we are shifting the idea of what it means to be public and what it means to be private. And the personal blogs are a perfect example of that. When the first wave of blogs came along around 2004, 2005, when it all exploded, people were shocked at how personal blogs were, how private they were, that, you know, you would show pictures of children, you know, all these private things, you throw them out because of their interest. The funny thing is, I never believed in that. I just believed that private and public were trading places. Because we have a need for the private, that sort of universal always stays with us. But we can change. This is how we change values and beliefs. We always have to have beliefs. If Adam and Eve is the only story provided to you, you will believe in it because you have to have a story. You have to have an idea of where you come from. Otherwise, you're free. So you use the stories that are available to you and take the most credible story, and that's your story. That's what we always do as human beings. And I believe it's the same thing. I am a very public person, especially in Sweden, here in Russia too. People seem to think they know a lot about me. In reality, what I give them is a story that they like. And I make things up as I go along. And give them a story that they like. And then I tell them, oh, by the way, this is just a story. Because I actually keep my privacy very strictly to myself and those who I live with. Because they're not public people and they don't want to. So I just think private and public are eternal needs, exist in all societies. They're very human, it's just like feeding and eating and all those things. But we should be open to the fact that private and public are in very many cases trading places right now. Things that used to be private are becoming public, things that used to be public are becoming more private. And the perfect example of that is that you would be very, very willing 15 years ago to tell people who you socialize with. Somebody asked, do you know this person? Yeah, I know this person. No, I don't know this person. There's somebody you're very willing. That is a highly tradable commodity. We are no longer ready to tell people who we know unless we get something in return. And most people today are getting asked, who do you know? They go back, well, I might tell you if you tell me who you know. Otherwise, I'll tell you. So, you know, has become private, which used to be very public. Because you could walk down the street in the square, and everybody would see you, you could say hello to you, you could say hello to. And they would know the gossip you were spreading because you didn't like the character of a lady, but you liked a lady at a supermarket. That is not becoming private. So we're just switching these things. The needs are always there. Yeah?
I have two questions. How can I comment that all through these four phases, the mass media interaction and other stuff, we have less and less meaning in this information. From the written form to the interactive, we had huge volumes of philosophy, and now we have one of the posts, Ayman Strelka with Alexander Bard. Just it. And it's becomes more and more stupid. What will be the next?
No, it does not. I've written three books. The first book was published in English. It's then been published in 17 languages. It has sold in 340,000 copies. It's probably the best-selling work of philosophy in the world in the last 150 years. You're talking to the world's best-selling philosopher right now. Except people didn't get that it was a philosophy book. But they didn't get that Nietzsche wrote philosophy either. It was only in the 1920s that he was identified a philosopher because he was so fucking unique. People didn't get that he was a philosopher. They said he's a crazy poet when he lived. He wasn't. He was probably the deepest shit philosopher we had in the last 600 years. You're just looking in the wrong place. You're asking the wrong question. People are not getting stupider. They're getting smarter, if anything. But they're using less of their brain, and their smartness is moving into the machines. It doesn't mean they're more stupid. They're smart.
Okay, and then
I'll give you one thing more. The values here. This has to do with values. Beliefs, values. I would define that we're moving away from secular morality and we're moving into something called interactive ethics. Morality is dying. Morality is value systems based on a patriarch or a judge who tells us what to do. That's a dying. What we instead have today, if you go online today, probably the most popular topic online is endless debates on what is the right or the wrong thing to do. People are obsessed with ethics. It can't be stupid if they're obsessed with ethics. That's the most philosophical issue that exists. They're obsessed with philosophy. They're obsessed with ethics. Reality TV shows. What are they about? They're about people freaking out, doing all kinds of weird things, and then you judge you whether it's right or wrong. And you love to get involved in those discussions because those discussions run forever online. Was it right of Beatrice to hit Hans? I don't know. It was right. No, it was wrong. And they go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. That is ethics. Ethics is values in constant flux, constantly on the move, that always refer not to a judge, not to a Stalin or a Putin or a Napoleon. It's values that refer to their internal process. Cause and effect. Who wins the debate on ethics on the internet? The guy who wins the debate is the guy who can show, well, if Beatrice hits Hans, it will result in this outcome for Beatrice and for Hans. Whereas if Beatrice doesn't hit Hans, it will result in this outcome for Beatrice and for Hans. That is how we now start to value. That is how we start to judge human behavior. We start to judge it from what will it result in? What is the likely outcome of this behavior? And that determines whether we like it or not. And so what is then the ideal outcome? The ideal outcome, it created a social sphere of creativity and entertainment. Anything that people do these days, that we see more people getting in touch with each other, liking each other, doing fun, creative things together, is deemed ideal. That's why it's called interactive ethics. So we're leaving morality behind and moving into a very ethical society, where brands will be judged ethically, where you will be judged ethically by others, as an ethical being. Who are you? You are your behavior. Why do you behave the way you do? That will determine whether people will want to get involved with you.
Thank you.
Okay.